gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed for their country by another way. The Gospel of the Lord. Again, welcome, welcome, welcome to those of you who have been traveling the past few days to make your way down to Central Florida. The peppermint bark at the rectory, I still have some. I have some peppermint ice cream from Kilwin's up here. Oh my goodness, that is sinful. And of course, I know, thank goodness my dad and mom are not watching me, except from heaven, because you should never do this at home. Open it up and just eat it out of the container. No, it's a big surprise for anybody else. That's all I have to say, right? Just a big surprise. But it's nice to come in and see. And I really am grateful to those of you who on Fridays tidy up the church. And, you know, the leaves fall. And they'll fall by Monday and all. And next week, we still get to enjoy the poinsettias for the feast of the baptism of the Lord. And then quickly, within moments, the Christmas season ends. But we have so more time. And today is, around the world, a very big celebration. Tuesday, January 6th, Epiphany. Ah, little Christmas. And we celebrate little Christmas for all those non-Jewish believers. In other words, the Jewish people, the shepherds, saw Christ first. And then, all the foreigners. The foreigners who had no tradition of the Jewish faith. And unless they were very serious scholars, they were not reading the Torah. They were not sort of studying all that was coming true, all the prophecies from King David in his Psalms to Abraham, who was promised the Christ among his own. And all these prophecies are all coming true. It's astounding. But the believers, not all the believers, were obedient to God. Herod, not overjoyed, but in fear. The shepherds were obedient to God. And they, too, they saw the Christ child. They were absolutely overjoyed. It's an awesome time of year. I enjoy it with you and also my own family. All my siblings, the Clampets, they all make their way to celebration here. And why? Because of the Mass schedule. You know, I have to be here for Mass. My brother John and Bishop, they have to be at St. James Cathedral. And so they all make their way here. That's our tradition. It's always been that way at the rectory in Sanford and now the rectory here at Corpus Christi. And they all come in different ways. And, you know, I guess I shouldn't talk too much about family, but it does astound me. There's 14 of us. Some don't go to Mass. Oh, they're the most loyal Catholics in the world. Oh my goodness, you know, they shoot you if they didn't, you know, if you said anything bad about the Pope or anybody. It's like, in my head kind of is like this. Like, how can you celebrate Christmas and not go to Mass? You know? I mean, it's not like they've been off a few days before. All the gifts were wrapped. Everything was done. They can only prepare so much food in the house, right? It's ready. In fact, they haven't done it the day before, the pans all ready and even sliced, all just ready to be warmed up. And I sort of wonder about that. And I scratch my head because I think it's a sad thing to say. And you may have a few family members that didn't celebrate Mass or Christmas. And you might join in, and there's a sadness, and I think certainly God himself is sad. It's like, I want you with the whole family. It would be as if one of our family members was serving overseas in the armed forces. The seat would be empty, and we'd be all like, You know, there'd just be that sadness. And I sort of wonder about that. It's like, you've been given the faith. You have seen Christ. You were baptized in the faith. Good grief. What happened? What did you feel on your first Holy Communion? What did you feel in your white dress or your white suit coming down the aisle, hands folded? Okay, you're marching down, you're nervous. Okay, what's that gonna? It's gonna taste like, right? It's gonna cut. I was taught as a kid, it's gonna cut my throat. It's like, what do you mean you can't chew it? And my dad says, well, it just dissolves. And what do you mean? Is it like hard candy? We never had the opportunity, like the children today, to kind of prepare yourself by testing just the bread before it's consecrated. And then in confession, think of the joy. It's not fun going, let me tell you. But I don't know about you, but there have been many times I've gone to confession, and I leave the confession, and I'm like walking on air. It's just like, wow. Oh my gosh, thank you. It's just like a huge burden off your shoulder. And many of you, for your wedding day, what did you feel? Oh, it's just another day. No. It was glorious. When I was ordained a priest, I'll never forget the feeling. And when I was given my first blessings, I honestly thought I could have people walk again. I just felt like, oh my goodness, right? And then I'm at the altar the day after for my first Mass. And my hands are like trembling. And there's like all these priests, a whole slew of the older clergy, the Irish clergy, all watching. Just making sure everything was done properly. And then it was like, for a split second, oh my gosh, what's going on here? And who's sitting down here but a father and a mother, and with five siblings and the whole Clampett family? And they're like, what's he doing up there? He doesn't belong up there. With all those ancient priests. How does he get to be up there? Remember the feeling you had. How did we lose that? How does one lose? What attacks our soul so that we lose that tremendous joy that the shepherds had? It always gets me, the Magi, the foreigners. They weren't overjoyed at seeing Jesus. What were they overjoyed at seeing? The star. How bizarre is that, right? But I think of the Magi as, they're astrologists. They're stargazers. No wrong. Remember, they're not ones who make all these predictions. It's not like that. They actually look at the stars. They're scientists. They study the stars. They're a little different from us, but they're pretty smart. And God speaks to them in their own language. I would say the language of science. God speaks to them. They are looking at the stars and goes, okay, I'll talk to you this way. And God does speak to us in many different ways. In other words, it's just not. Maybe God, if you're musically inclined, God speaks to you at Christmas, especially through the beautiful music that's played. Or maybe by the way someone is reading so well and well thought out, and prepared. Maybe you're inspired by the younger students who are serving Mass. Maybe it's just us all coming together as one family, people's thoughtfulness. Somehow, God speaks to us in many different ways. But we have to open our ears to God. There are many Epiphany stories, about the many, 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 many people that traveled with these Magi. See, we can just presume there's three of them. But there's lots of stories, again, not scriptural, but stories, of hosts and hosts of people traveling. And it seems like a year or two, and they're traveling. And people get discouraged, and they go back home. We're not in for this long. And more and more dropped off until there's only three left. And they persevered. And God blessed them for their perseverance. And so now, the strangers, not just the Jewish people, God called a representatives of the Jewish people. Who? The poorest, low-class people there were. The shepherds. Will you be obedient to the angel? And the shepherds were. And because they were obedient, they see the Christ child. Upon seeing the Christ child, they leave absolutely incredulous with joy. And as we are obedient to God, we too are given a tremendous joy. I think of those people who are converts to our faith. My mom was one. Her whole childhood, she knew nothing about Roman Catholics. Her whole teenage and childhood years, she never went to church because her parents had no faith. Not different faith, not a little faith, zero faith. And so I asked my mom once, you know, when I was younger, I said, Mom, what was your impression of Roman Catholics? I mean, what did you think of them? And she said, you know, I got to tell you, I always thought of them, that you had to be special and you had to be asked to become a Roman Catholic. That was her impression. I said, well, aren't you lucky? Aren't you blessed? And I always reminded her, I was Catholic before you. Because when I, as soon as I was born, what did great grandma say to my dad? My great grandson will be baptized. And let me tell you, if he did, flames everywhere. And so very quickly, I was baptized. And 3 years later, a woman now with two children, later to have a total of six, takes her classes and becomes Roman Catholic. And I watched her. She really enjoyed this great faith until the moment she died. And yet I think, wow, what is celebrating Christmas like? What's it like when you have no faith? When you see a plastic baby or a ceramic baby in a crib with a pretty angel on top, and a man and a woman, and a bunch of farm animals all around. What do you see? I mean, I know what we see, because we have been so blessed having the faith. But what is it that non-believers, and there are many out there over the planet, what do they see? They see a lot of shopping, yeah. They see a lot of Christmas lights, oh yeah. A lot of singing, oh yeah. A lot of food, oh yeah. But what do they see? Because somehow, even in their no lack of any faith, the Magi set out and they searched. They were so hungry for something. They were hungry. I mean, you don't just get on your camels or get on your donkeys and go for a long time unless you're hungry. And they were searching. And they found without all the assurances. In other words, they knew they found it. They knew they found the Christ. They knew it. They were assured about it. Thank goodness. Thank you, God. I didn't have to wait till I was a grown man to gaze on the Christ child. Thank God for all of you born into this faith, living the faith, that when you look at a little plastic manger, a little ceramic manger, you know what it means. And just not gathering around a Christmas tree and having a little dinner, it's a lot more than that. It's a joy that's forever, isn't it? It's a joy that doesn't last just for the day. We had the kids together. No one fought. Okay. No. It's a joy that we have, a gift we have, that will get us into heaven, that takes us all the way to heaven. Really. This Christmas joy, this knowing the Christ child, this living like Jesus Christ, a reflection of Him, that's enough joy to get us all the way to heaven. Let us stand and pray. Together, we profess our faith.